Okay, so we're going to go ahead and get started. I do want to thank the first opening keynote panel again for doing such a tremendous job and really outlining a lot of the key issues that we want to address today. And I think that they've really given us a lot of food for thought today and really laid out the issues well. So next, we want to move forward in terms of thinking about innovations in concepts and methods for the social sciences and public health. And again, with this panel, our idea was to get panelists that we thought were doing really innovative and interdisciplinary research in the social sciences and public health. And again, we really wanted to focus on people who we felt were bridging multiple disciplines within their own work. And the theme kind of uniting a lot of their work is social inequalities in health. This panel is being moderated by our own Professor Patrick Wilson in the Department of Social Medical Sciences. So I'm going to pass it over to him, and then we're going to, I encourage you, as a big theme this morning was in-person networking, we're going to have lunch afterwards, and I really encourage you to get to know the other people in the room today. So thank you.
So thank you, Rachel. We're actually just going to jump right in. This is the panel on innovations and concepts and methods for the social sciences and public health. And the first speaker that we'll have is Seth Stephens-Davidowitz at the New York Times and Google. So, Seth.
All right, so thanks everybody for having me. Thanks for having me. Thanks everybody for attending. So I'll give a little background on where I come from and my background on these topics. About 3 years ago, I was an economics graduate student, and I was pretty burnt out and lost. And then I discovered Google search data, Google Trends. You can find it online. And it has all this information on what people search, where they, what the search volume for different terms over time and across space. And I just thought this was basically the coolest data set I'd ever seen, and way cooler than all the data sets that people were using in social sciences at that point, and that there had to be tons and tons of information in this data set about big, big questions. How much racism cost President Obama, the size of the gay male population, which I'll talk about today, and other kind of big questions based on this data source. And kind of a big theme that I've been exploring over the last 3 years is this idea that in the digital space, in all this data that we're leaving online, much of it just as we go through life, not contrived surveys, but just the questions we ask on Google or the sites we click on as we go through life, when you make it anonymous and aggregate, there's really revolutionary information in who we are in that site. And I think some of the implications on health are pretty obvious. Lots of the questions that people in Health Explore have been complicated by social desirability bias. And I think the Google might be the most powerful data set we've ever had on global health. And I encourage people to really consider this data set. We've talked about there's some interdisciplinary stuff. I don't really know. I kind of just explore whatever's interesting to me, and then I never really know what journals would accept them. And every time I've tried, they've just been rejected. So I just write them in newspapers now. That's why I'm a columnist. And I kind of just been ignoring the whole academic process, which has its pluses and minuses. Probably, you know, I do respect the peer review process, and I'm sure that I've made some mistakes due to this process of just ignoring it. But so I wouldn't necessarily encourage that, but I'm kind of trying to figure out maybe more of a home in academia in the future. But this is estimating the closeted gay male population. This kind of, I think, really captures a lot of the themes that I've been exploring and a lot of things that I think you can do with this data. This is clearly a complicated question for obvious reasons. This is something that people aren't comfortable admitting. And I think there are two main points I wanted you to take away from this brief talk, which is that there remain a lot of closeted gay men in less tolerant parts of the United States, and that's clear in the data. And that new data sources will prove really important for social scientists and people in public health. So let me start with a beginning fact, and this you don't need necessarily new data sources to find. There are far more openly gay men in states with more tolerant attitudes to homosexuality. How do we measure attitudes towards homosexuality? Nate Silver put together a list basically of every state, what percent of people in that state support gay marriage based on polling data and some other information. And you can see there are big differences in the level of acceptance in different parts of the United States. So the most tolerant state is Rhode Island, where Rhode Island scores number one as most tolerant state for homosexuality as far as support for gay marriage. Then the least tolerant state is Mississippi, and you can see parts of the Deep South are a lot less tolerant, have a lot less tolerant attitudes towards homosexuality. So you can measure the openly gay population, and this obviously is different degrees of openness. Census has same-sex relationships. This is only people actually in relationships living with a partner, and you have to admit it to a government survey. Only about 1% of relationships are same-sex according to the census. Gallup polls will have about 3% of the population is, between 3 and 4% of the population is gay or bisexual. And then this new one that I explored is Facebook profiles. People, when you create a Facebook profile, you're asked what gender you're interested in. About 50% include information on that, whether they're interested in men or women. And they all give very similar maps of the United States. And this is on the x-axis. We have that first map, which with Rhode Island, also DC on the top, as places where support for gay marriage is highest. And on the y-axis, this is percent of all Facebook profiles that include a gender they're interested in, what percent are interested in males. And you can see that there's a very, very strong relationship here. In places where support for gay marriage is the highest, about 3% of men are gonna say they're who list a gender of interest are gonna say they're interested in males. But in states like Mississippi, where the support for gay marriage is very low, only about 1% of men who list a gender are gonna say they're interested in men. So right away, there are two explanations for this, right? There's either or both, almost certainly, who are born in Mississippi or Alabama are gonna move out of these states because they aren't accepting of their sexuality and move into places like Massachusetts or Rhode Island or DC. And the second explanation is they're not going to be open about their sexuality because there are costs of being open about sexuality in a place where intolerance is high. And Gallup is too small a survey and doesn't have information on where people are born, but the cool thing about Facebook data is they also ask you your hometown. They ask you where you were born, where you grew up. So this, unfortunately, the data on this is limited. It's a limited subsample, and I'm working on getting the complete data source for this. But I looked at this. I basically redid the analysis, what percent of people are gay by state of birth rather than state of current residence. And you can see that the relationship is smaller. It's this graph. I apologize, it's a little confusing. It's the red line. The relationship is smaller. Some of the differences in the size of the openly gay population are most definitely due to mobility. People do move out, gay men do move out of states like Mississippi and into states like Rhode Island or California. But this does not go all the way to explain the differences in the gay population. There are still large significant differences in the gay population by state of birth, in the openly gay population by state of birth, which I think is due to them, to gay men living in the closet there and not being open about their sexuality. Another way to look at this question, and this is another example of the power of these new data sources, if you asked the census or Gallup, they would not have information on high school students. But Facebook, you can break down the data by high school population. And this is both interesting just because the high school population is interesting and also because men haven't chosen where to live in high school. And you can see, again, not as profound a relationship, but a very statistically significant relationship between the tolerance towards homosexuality and the size of the openly gay male population in high school. Only about a little over 1% of men who list a gender of interest on Facebook in high school say they're interested in men. And in the most tolerant states, it's gonna be about 1.5%. So in Rhode Island, Massachusetts, New York, Connecticut, about 1.5% of high school men are gonna say they're interested in men who list an interest, a gender of interest. In Mississippi, it's 1 in 1,000 actually only. So very, very rare. Actually, they might have even been just accidentally clicked on it, so it's not even clear that when you look at them, when you look at the information, like many aren't in a relationship with a man, so it's not clear, or it might even be in a relationship with a woman, so that might even just be error, which is true in any data set, even the census, people accidentally click the wrong gender or wrong interest. So, So there still is a relationship in high school. And I think you put these two points from Facebook together, I think you see that mobility is explaining some of the differences, but there still are, it doesn't explain all the differences. There still are differences in openness of sexuality in the gay population. Another way to look at this is, and again, this is where I kind of built more of my career, is with the Google searches. And the huge advantage of this is, again, less social desirability bias on Google. You can think about what scholars have found consistently is that people are more honest when they're online, when they're alone, when they're not participating, don't think they're participating in an official survey. Google's the ideal conditions for capturing what people are really thinking and really desire. And this data is all anonymous and aggregate, and that's obviously really important for protecting people's privacy if we are going to explore these sensitive topics. So I just looked at the percent of Google searches that were for gay porn, and these are categorized based on a whole bunch of information, but it might be a gay porn site, or you know, a particularly male porn star would be a gay porn search, whereas a straight, you know, for a female porn star would be just a normal porn search. And you can see that about 5% of pornographic searches are for gay male porn. And the percent is higher in states that are more tolerant to homosexuality. And I think that is because there legitimately are more people living in, more gay men in San Francisco or in DC or in Rhode Island or in Massachusetts because there is some mobility. But the differences you can see are not nearly as strong as the differences in the openly male population. So I think this is more evidence consistent with the Facebook data that the true gay population is more similar in the country than you would get from the openly gay population. And you put these differences, you put these different data points together, this would suggest that there are more closet gay men in less tolerant parts of the country because they're not open about their sexuality as controlling for how much gay male interest there is in these places, there's actually less openness about this sexuality. Two more pieces of evidence of this. This is if you questions about a husband on Google, the most frequent question about a husband is his sexuality. Actually, questions about a husband being gay are 10% more common than questions about a husband being cheating. And about 10 times more common than a husband being depressed. So this is the most frequent question that wives have about their husbands. And you might think, I'm not gonna say that wives are perfectly certain about the sexuality of a husband, but you might think that they have some clues about this issue. And you can see an overwhelming relationship that in areas where tolerance is lowest, these searches are most, the percent of Google searches for is husband gay or is my husband gay or various permutations of this are significantly higher. This isn't as strong, but this is consistent. I also just went to Craigslist, and you can go to Craigslist. You can go for every city, basically click on. You can click on for any city, male for male, casual encounters, and these are kind of advertise themselves as anonymous sexual encounters, where you don't, not really open sexuality necessarily. And talking to a lot of people in these areas, a lot of gay men in Mississippi and Alabama, they say that this is very common, that they've slept with a lot of married men through Craigslist anonymous casual encounters. And the relationship isn't as strong, but it's still statistically significant, where in areas where tolerance is, where there's less tolerance to homosexuality, where fewer people support gay marriage, there are definitely a higher percent of casual encounter ads that are looking for men. And yesterday I gave this talk at the Public School of Health, and I got attacked for drawing a little too much from my data, which another issue I have with academia, this is my fault, I tend to be a little more provocative and like to make large jumps from data. So I think I found a nice place in newspapers for that. But I don't know if you want to go as strong as I kind of like the tone of that I've solved the size of the gay population. Nobody needs to research this anymore. I think I would say that two things I would draw from this data definitely is that there still is a large closet gay male population due to intolerance. We can directly correlate with intolerance. I think more importantly that this data source for a question like this for the gay male population, there really is a lot of information in these new data sources, Craigslist, Google searches, Facebook, whatever the final, I'm sure a lot of more people are gonna look at this data and maybe correct some of my conclusions or extend some of my conclusions and find a little more. But I think if you're interested in a topic that where information has been limited because people maybe don't want to tell the truth necessarily, or for other or for similar reasons, really consider some of these new data sources as getting some new conclusions on this. So I encourage everybody to consider these new data sources, and that's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you, Seth. So next we will have Dr. Mark Hatzenbuehler from the Mailman School of Public Health.
All right. I'm going to talk about some of the work that my colleagues and I have done in the area of stigma and the health of lesbian, gay, and bisexual populations. As this figure shows, there are multiple levels through which stigma operates to disadvantage those who are targeted by it. For example, stigmatized individuals can internalize negative societal attitudes about their group, a process known as self-stigma. At the interpersonal level, there are interpersonal events like bias-based hate crimes that, of course, also can harm the stigmatized. And then finally, at the structural level, there are broad institutional policies and practices that constrain the opportunities and resources and well-being of the stigmatized. And although there's been a lot of really great theoretical work positing the existence of these structural forms of stigma, there's been less empirical research documenting the impact of structural forms of stigma on health. And that's due in part to some of the difficulties in measuring and operationalizing this construct, and also to finding appropriate data structures to test its health impact. And so part of my research program has been focused on trying to develop creative strategies for testing the health consequences of structural stigma. And in the very brief time I have today, I'm going to talk about three different strategies that my colleagues and I have used. So one measure of structural stigma, and Seth anticipated this in his talk, are social policies that differentially target this group for social exclusion here in the US. And so one of the strategies we've used is to take advantage in the multiple naturally occurring changes in these social policies so that we can conduct natural experiments to test the impact of this form of stigma on health. As you can imagine, it's really difficult to do these kinds of natural experiments because we can't anticipate when these policies occur, and so it's hard to get access to baseline data before the policies change. But we were able to take advantage of an opportunity to conduct one of these natural experiments during the presidential elections of 2004 when 16 states passed a constitutional amendment banning same-sex marriage. And it just so happened that these events occurred in between the two data collection periods of a longitudinal, nationally representative survey of U.S. adults. Respondents were first interviewed in 2001, and then the same respondents were re-interviewed again 4 years later in 2005, following the passage of the same-sex marriage bans. And so this created a natural experiment where we could examine changes in the prevalence of psychiatric morbidity among LGB respondents who had been assessed both before and after the passage of the bans. And our results showed that LGB adults who lived in these states that banned same-sex marriage through these constitutional amendments experienced significant increases in a broad range of psychiatric disorders. For the sake of time, I'm just going to show the results for any mood disorder, which are shown on the y-axis here. And on the x-axis is the state of residence. So on the left-hand side here are the LGB respondents living in a state that banned same-sex marriage. And on the right-hand side are LGB respondents living in a state that didn't ban same-sex marriage. And you can see at wave one, before the passage of the marriage bans, there was the prevalence rates were identical between the two groups. But in contrast, in wave two, following the passage of the gay marriage bans, there was a significant increase in mood disorders among the LGB respondents who lived in one of those states that banned same-sex marriage, but not among those who lived in a state that didn't ban same-sex marriage. And if anything, you can see there's a trend here towards a protective effect of living in the state that didn't ban same-sex marriage. So another measure that we've used of structural stigma are social policy or social norms and social attitudes about the permissibility and acceptability of homosexuality. A second strategy is to take advantage of the large geographic and spatial variation in these attitudes so that we can test the health impact of this form of structural discrimination and structural stigma. And it's certainly the case that social attitudes towards gays and lesbians have improved, but there's still substantial spatial and geographic variation in these attitudes. So these are data that have been aggregated from 41 national opinion polls. This is the percentage of individuals living in the states who believe that same-sex couples should be able to adopt children. You can see this ranges from a low of only 26% in Oklahoma to about 56% in New York. So we were able to utilize a really innovative data set that my colleague Peter Munich here created, which linked the General Social Survey to the National Death Index. What we were able to do is to use that data to examine the impact of these community-level prejudicial attitudes on mortality risk among sexual minorities. And so to do this, we took the four different measures of social attitudes towards gays and lesbians that have been repeatedly assessed in the General Social Survey, and we aggregated those individual responses up to the community level. And so the innovation here is we're not asking LGB respondents about their perceptions of the attitudes in their communities, but instead we're asking the actual community members themselves about their own attitudes towards gays and lesbians. And then we aggregate that up to the community level such that each community has an average prejudice score. So in this hypothetical example here, you can see that the community of Shelby County and Tennessee have very high levels of prejudicial attitudes towards gays and lesbians. But in contrast, the community of San Francisco has very low levels of prejudicial attitudes. And then from the General Social Survey, we also know the sexual orientation of individuals who live in those communities. And finally, because this data has been linked to the National Death Index, we actually have mortality information on those same individuals as well. So these are the data from the study. These are the survival curves showing elevated mortality risk among the sexual minorities who lived in the highest structural stigma communities. You can see here that by the end of the study, 92% of sexual minorities who lived in the lowest structural stigma communities were still alive at the end of the study. But in contrast, only 78% of sexual minorities who lived in the highest structural stigma communities were still alive by the end of the study. And these results remain robust after controlling for a variety of risk factors at both the individual and community level. And for me, one of the most striking findings was that we found that the life expectancy differences between sexual minorities who lived in the highest versus low structural stigma communities was comparable to life expectancy differences that have been observed for education and socioeconomic status, suggesting that stigma should be considered alongside some of the other major social determinants of premature mortality. So a third and final strategy that we've used is to try and develop and evaluate mechanistic explanations for being able to identify the actual pathways through which structural stigma contributes to adverse health outcomes. And for this, we've moved from these large-scale data sets into the laboratory to use experimental paradigms where we can experimentally control the stimuli that are presented to the LGB respondents. So in one example of this work, we had participants come into the lab and they participated in the Trier social stress test. This is one of the most well-validated stress paradigms. They have to give a 5-minute speech task, and the topic is to talk about a time in which they've been discriminated against or rejected because of their sexual orientation. And they have to give that speech in front of two evaluators. They're told that these evaluators are researchers who have extensive experience in speech evaluation, but unbeknownst to them, they are actual confederates that we've trained, and we've trained them to give no positive feedback. So they can only give neutral feedback. They can't smile, they can't nod, they look kind of bored, they roll their eyes, they look at their watch. So it's a highly stressful experience. And if that's not bad enough, they also have to then do a 5-minute stress math task afterwards. Yeah, that's even worse. Then what we do is we collect saliva samples at a couple different time points that we assay for cortisol, which is a stress hormone. And then our research question here is, does exposure to structural stigma actually affect your cortisol response to the same stimulus in the lab? So these are the data here. On the y-axis is the cortisol output. On the x-axis are the three time points. This is baseline, reactivity, and recovery from the stressor. And we're comparing cortisol output for those who grew up in low versus high structural stigma environments. And you can see here a blunted cortisol response to the Trier social stress test for those who grew up in the highest structural stigma environments. And these kinds of blunted cortisol responses have also been observed in other highly stressed samples, including youths who have been maltreated, and also individuals with post-traumatic stress disorder, suggesting that these structural forms of stigma may be biologically embedded to produce adverse health outcomes. So in conclusion, we've used a multi-method, multi-measure approach to studying the health consequences of structural stigma. And we've done this in order to try and establish convergence or triangulation across these different methods and measurement approaches in order to try and improve causal inferences about these relationships between structural stigma and health. And this work has demonstrated, I think, really broad and far-reaching health consequences of structural stigma, ranging from maladaptive physiologic stress profiles in the lab all the way up to premature mortality at a population level. And then finally, several of these studies have been cited in court cases and amicus briefs for status-based court cases around status-based discrimination. So I think one example of connecting social science research to inform public policies, and this is a topic that we're going to get to in the third panel today later, so just anticipating that. So that's it. Thank you for your attention, and just want to acknowledge all the great collaborators and funders for this work. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark. Now we'll have Dr. Elizabeth Sweet from the University of Massachusetts in Boston.
Thank you so much. I really want to thank you for being here and for inviting me to participate in this wonderful symposium. I'm having such a good time listening to all of these wonderful presentations and discussions. I've been asked to speak about my work on symbolic capital and health, and I'm going to try to do this briefly with just one example of some of my work in this area. And whenever I talk about this issue, I always like to start by just painting the picture of economic inequality more broadly, because this, of course, is the context within which symbolic capital has its salience. It's the fabric within which symbolic capital sits. And we're all familiar with these statistics. Of course, economic inequality is a big issue. It's been rising globally. It's particularly stark here in the United States, where the differences in income between those at the top and the bottom of the ladder are ever widening. And we see these dramatic differences with the top 1% controlling 24% of the total income share in the country, the top 3% controlling almost 55% of all of the wealth. And of course, we know that this inequality and these income gaps matter for health, and that income and other measures of socioeconomic status are strongly associated with health and disease. And of course, we also know there's been a lot of work that has gone into understanding why. This is an oversimplified model highlighting two sort of primary pathways, one operating through the ways in which socioeconomic status can constrain our access to resources and opportunities, another pathway operating through psychosocial stress. Both of these can impact health behaviors and also act directly on health outcomes themselves. And of course, all of this operating over the life course. And I'm going to focus on the psychosocial pathway, which again, simplified, looks like this. And what I think is interesting about this pathway is that we know that this sort of second arrow, the link between stress and health, is really robust. There have been decades of work now showing that these processes involving the sympathetic nervous system, the HPA axis, this mutual regulation between the HPA axis and inflammatory signals, we all know that this results from stress. We know that chronic stress can have a profound impact on health and disease. What's interesting, though, is I think it's the first arrow that is somewhat less robust. One of the hypothesized mechanisms involves feelings of relative deprivation resulting from negative social comparisons with those higher on the socioeconomic ladder. However, that process of relative deprivation and the stress that results from it, I think, is often assumed or taken for granted more than it is explicitly operationalized. In particular, we typically rely on basic SES measures like income or education and infer relative deprivation based on their association with a stress-related health outcome. In other words, the way in which relative deprivation happens and is experienced is not often part of our measurement models. Which leaves a really big question regarding how feelings of relative deprivation actually occur. In order to feel deprived compared to someone else, we first need to understand how social position or status in society is determined. Then we can understand our own place in the social hierarchy and how we relate to others. And this has been a bit of a black box in the epidemiology of the social gradient. In particular, while income may be an excellent measure for empirically evaluating socioeconomic hierarchy in U.S. society, it's not likely to be the actual metric used by individuals in making conscious or unconscious social comparisons, because explicit income information is rarely shared, even with close friends and family. So again, that leaves us with this question of how do we know? How do we understand what status is, and how to determine our own status? And as an anthropologist, I, of course, answer through culture. Social status is socially and culturally constructed. We have a shared understanding of what kinds of cues we should use, be they behavioral, visual, material, etc., to determine status. And so as a researcher, I need to determine what that shared understanding or shared cultural model of status is, and then I can use that to better understand the place of individuals within that culturally constructed status hierarchy in a way that's likely more relevant and meaningful for them than just a measure of income. And this is what I've done in my work, using a mixed methods approach from anthropology called cultural consensus and consonance. I'm not going to go into detail about these methods, but basically cultural consensus combines qualitative and quantitative information from individuals to evaluate the degree to which beliefs about, for instance, what determines social status, are shared and therefore cultural. After that cultural model is uncovered, cultural consonance can then assess individual fit with the model, the degree to which an individual conforms with shared understandings of, for instance, how to have social status. Consonance then gives us a culturally salient measure of one's social status or their position within a culturally constructed and endorsed status hierarchy. So I employed this method in a study of social status and stress for teenagers in a community called Maywood, which is a lower income African American community in Chicago, and found, not surprisingly, that consumption-based material items are an important way in which social status is culturally understood and measured. After several months of qualitative and ethnographic research, I did a consensus analysis that revealed two main models of status for this group of teens. One comprised of fairly inexpensive and ubiquitous material items, such as K-Swiss tennis shoes, and some other behavioral indicators, such as being on sports teams. And a second model that consisted of higher priced and higher status, according to the ethnography, items like Juicy Couture brand clothes and Razor cell phones. This was, of course, over 10 years ago now. I then used this to measure teens' actual status as a function of this cultural model, their cultural consonance or ownership of those material possessions that were found to be the most important indicators of status in their social lives. Importantly, I also collected data about their family's SES in order to compare this cultural measure to a more conventional method of assessing status. And when I looked at how consonance, or again, ownership of those high status items, was associated with a health indicator, namely their blood pressure, I found that owning high status goods was, as expected, associated with lower blood pressure for these teens, and not owning status goods was associated with higher blood pressure. But it was only for those teens whose families had higher SES. For those from lower SES families, the opposite was true. Owning more high status goods was associated with higher blood pressure. So how can we understand this? The first thing to note is that for these teens, standard measures of SES, like income and education, were not how they understood status to be defined and enacted, and they alone did not predict their blood pressure. Rather, their model of status relied heavily on consumer symbols, the carriers of symbolic capital. And this, of course, reflects a legacy of more symbolic views of status in the social sciences, going back to the work of Weber and Veblen, and the idea of conspicuous consumption as a primary vehicle through which status distinctions are constituted and enacted. The teens model also highlights the importance of highly visible markers in contemporary consumer society. As Bourdieu observed, class is defined as much by its being perceived as by its being. And this being perceived was very important for Maywood teens, where consumer symbols were not just elements of status, but also identity and power. They were used as tools in the exercise of stigma and social exclusion and acceptance. As one 16-year-old girl described, the social importance of having visibly new consumer goods, if your shoes are raggedy, you get talked about. Even if you have on Air Force Ones, if they're raggedy, you get talked about. And that was a big deal for them. Consumer symbols also represented power to them in the sense of being vehicles through which the absence of money capital was confronted and negotiated. The same girl observed, that's what it's about, acting like you've got money. And it's in this way that the role of consumption goods and symbolic capital in the lives of Maywood teens illustrates the inherent tension in what's been called the neoliberalization of social life. The process in which, in the deregulated economic worlds of late capitalism, consumption becomes a predominant social force, concealing a complicated relationship with underlying structural divisions. Where fragmented youth and race-based niche markets, just as we see reflected in the consumer status models of Maywood teens, participate in both an acceleration and expansion of consumer aspirations, which, as Juliet Shore has argued, couple with rising inequality to ratchet up the competitive consumption norms to which we are all subjected, while simultaneously making them harder to attain. And therein lies the inherent tension that's at the heart of why symbolic capital matters for health, a tension between what we need in order to have social esteem and what we can actually afford. And it's a tension that we can literally see being written into biologies, into bodies, biology, and health. So just in conclusion, I briefly discussed my work as a biocultural approach to this problem of understanding the relationship between SES and health. There's a lot of attention in biological anthropology, which is my primary field, and public health and other fields, given to the mechanistic processes that link biomarkers, such as those related to stress with disease and mortality. And those are, of course, very important mechanistic processes to better understand. But I think understanding this end of the process at the top is also important as a biocultural question. What does SES actually mean? What are the social, cultural, symbolic, and political processes through which it's constructed, enacted, experienced, and embodied? And those are questions that I think social scientists are, of course, very well able to contribute to in terms of the epidemiology of the social gradient. And I think using these kinds of mixed methods approaches is one way to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Elizabeth. So now we will have Dr. Valerie Purdie-Vaughns, who is from the Department of Psychology here at Columbia University.
I'm going to resist the urge to make jokes about shopping after that and conspicuous consumption. Okay, so just to begin, I have a confession, a story, and I'm going to talk about a model of psychological interventions. My confession is I am not a health psychologist. I actually know very little about health. I was trained as a social psychologist. I'm glad that Mark and Patrick think I know something about health. I have infiltrated the Robert Wood Johnson Health and Society Scholars, and we still are thinking about what health is. And so I'm thrilled to be here, but a little uncertain that I belong. A story about how a psychological intervention to reduce achievement gaps in school became a study about health disparities. So I'm a social psychologist. I'm trained to do laboratory experiments and field experiments. And I do them because I'm interested in causal inference and really understanding the connections between a psychological process and behavior. My work really began with a story of trying to understand racial achievement gaps in society, in particular in school contexts. And the model that we've been working with for many years was this idea that in situations, in contexts where there's a negative stereotype about a group, in the context of school, it's African Americans and Latinos, and the stereotype that they're not particularly intelligent, that they're not smart. This is something that's stressful, and over time, this kind of stress can undermine performance. So in my laboratory, what we've been doing is trying to reduce that stress, reduce how African American and Latinos appraise their environment as stressful, by integrating different kinds of psychological interventions into the social environment. How do we do this? So in one of our studies, this was a study that was ran at University of Colorado Boulder. We had 100 college students, and what's relevant about this is they were freshmen. So we got them when they first came to Colorado. Approximately half of them were Latino or white, and about a little over half were female. In this experiment, we brought them into the laboratory one at a time. They didn't think that it was a study at all about race or ethnicity or about identity. And we gave them an intervention exercise, a psychological intervention. We randomly assigned them to a treatment condition or a control condition. I'm going to show you what we did in a minute. The idea is that the treatment condition is a writing exercise that's designed to change the nature of how Latino students see stressful situations, and a control condition where they're just writing, but there isn't any sort of psychological active ingredient. We then, because remember, I don't know anything about health at this time, we are studying math performance. So we give them a very difficult math test. And right before we send them on their way, we just ask them about those self-report measures of what we're calling stereotype threat in the environment. How much do they think there are negative stereotypes about their racial group? So for the moment, that's the end of the study. I do hope I don't fall off the stage. Okay. So it's a very simple writing exercise. It looks like this, where there's an affirmation exercise. They just write about the circle their most important values. 85% of people write about their friends and family. Here's a sample that one participant wrote. Music and art are important to me on a very personal level because they are things I use to keep my head on straight, vent my emotions and frustration, and I am rarely without them. And I cannot imagine what a different person I would be without a constant soundtrack. I'm going to get back to what does a writing exercise like this actually do for a person's psychology. In the control condition, they write about the least important values to someone else. So they're still writing something, the idea that there isn't an active ingredient in there. So our sample item of what we're calling stereotype threat or social identity threat, it was actually 12 items, but here's a sample item. I sometimes worry that other students in my racial group were act in ways that make my race look unintelligent. So this general idea of are there negative stereotypes out there in the college climate. So we do this intervention exercise, randomly assigned treatment or control. They take this test. They do a self-report of stereotype threat. We then send them home. 2 years later, we got interested in health for a variety of different reasons. We knew that they were coming back in the laboratory to do a variety of different other measures. So what we did is that we measured their body mass. We did their waist to height ratio and their BMI. And so what did we find? When we wrote up the paper, it's not all a surprise like this. So I'm just letting you know how the story actually unfolded. What we found are two very interesting things. So here on the y-axis is body mass, where higher levels are higher levels of a body mass composite. Four participants that self-reported during their freshman year and that there was a very low sense of threat in the environment, that they didn't really see that there were negative stereotypes that were affecting them. There was no difference in their body mass as a function of our intervention condition. For students that during their freshman year reported that they had high levels of social identity threat, they thought that there were stereotypes about their group were rife in their college environment. When we did nothing to them, so when they were in the control condition, right here, we saw a significant increase in their body mass. For those that were in our affirmation condition, there's absolutely no difference 2 years later in their body mass index. So all of a sudden, what we thought we were looking at, which was academic achievement, you get the same effect with their transcripts, became something related to something more related to health. When we looked more deeply at the data, what we found is that this effect could be explained entirely by the Latino participants, our ethnic minority participants, that were high in social identity threat when they came to school. And that our intervention was able to effectively reduce this increase in body mass, particularly among that group. So this was really interesting to us, and we were trying to figure out why this might be. So if you back up, what are these values affirmations? They're psychological interventions. They're very short. They're 15-minute writing exercises, sometimes even 10 minutes. With our sixth and seventh graders, they can be even less. They bolster the perceived integrity of the self. They make us see ourselves as competent, effective, and able to control important outcomes. So it's the idea that you're importing this idea that you're a good person in an environment that is threatening and stressful. We know from social psychological research that it alters appraisals of stressful situations. So you know the situation is stressful, but it's a psychological immune system that kicks in, like, I can cope with this. We know that it changes your levels of control, so you're able to see the bigger picture, that this whole entire world of yours is not about this particular test. And we also know that it reduces defensiveness. So it opens you up to threatening information. So we know psychologically it's doing all these things, and we've known for many years that these kinds of psychological interventions can be introduced in the context of educational contexts, and in those contexts they can improve performance uniquely for the group under stereotypes, stereotype threat. And we know this for mostly women in the sciences, is where a lot of this work has been done, but also African Americans and Latinos in broader educational settings. So then we started thinking about what is a psychological explanation that could help us think about these health disparities, particularly in weight. Well, one, we know that negative stereotypes present a reoccurring psychological threat, that you, when you are in an environment where there are stereotypes about your group and it's chronic, this can be stressful. And like any chronic stressful threat may contribute to poor health. We also know that cortisol from stress stimulates appetite and triggers fat retention. And also we know that stress from stereotypes and the stress from social exclusion, the feeling of being left out, can undermine self-control and increase overindulgence. So when you put all of this together, what we're starting to see that when you think about a chart like this, where you're looking at the racial disparities in weight in the United States, most people start thinking about structural kinds of interventions, the built environment, or we might start thinking about eating behaviors or changing the plate size. But one of the things that we're starting to think seriously about is the psychological stress associated with not just direct experience of discrimination, but the idea that you belong to a group that can be stereotyped in a particular social context. Given that all of us belong to some kind of group of which contends with negative stereotypes, age being one of the most powerful stereotypes out there, that this is something that we think can start to contribute to understanding research on health disparities. So this has sort of led my lab and many others to start thinking, sort of importing many of our ideas from social psychology into the world of health. And so I want to end with talking about two different projects that we're working on, the promise of psychological interventions to reduce health disparities. One of the things that we're doing at the molecular level is that we're starting to look at the effect of these affirmation interventions, looking at biomarkers of cardiovascular disease, in particular looking at endothelial cell death. I'm quite thrilled every time I can say that word. Alongside of this, with my colleague David Williams at Harvard School of Public Health, I can't believe you public health people want to publish stuff with me, but I'm like, this is awesome. We've been working on a series of papers trying to understand the relationship between structural interventions and psychological interventions. And we wrote this, actually I wrote this paragraph, but I'll say we wrote this, that psychological interventions hold great promise in contributing to the reduction of health disparities. While they do not eliminate the source of race-related stress, they buffer people, they protect people from their pernicious effects by altering how people perceive, appraise, and respond to psychologically threatening interventions. That we're changing people's psychology that can then have this bottom-up effect to change the way they perceive their environment to improve health. And that small changes in a person's psychology can have enduring benefits, particularly when such psychological interventions are well-timed. And so we've been thinking a lot about this. And then also with my colleague Jonathan Cook and Elon Meyer, we've been developing a model. We all love this sort of Bronfenbrenner-esque structural to interpersonal, but in our model, what we've been doing is sort of thinking about the integration of different kinds of interventions. So you can have structural interventions, like for example, giving low-income women money. You can have structural interventions like putting a cancer screening institute on top of a YMCA or a local church. And those could be integrated with interpersonal kinds of interventions, perhaps increasing cultural competency for doctors to improve doctor-patient relationships. Those could be integrated. The way you make people open to all of these structural interventions is perhaps by changing their psychology, by making them feel a little less threatened, by making them feel open to receiving threatening information. And so therefore, some of the psychological interventions can be integrated smoothly into these structural and interpersonal interventions. And so the idea is that structural interventions can inform interpersonal and intrapersonal interventions, and intrapersonal interventions like the kind that we design can sort of have these bottom-up effects to affect the structure of our society. And so with that, I'd like to end that our work was very much informed by Yuri Bronfenbrenner, who says the relevant features of the environment include not only its objective properties, but also the way in which it is perceived by the person. And with that, that's finished. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Valerie, and thanks to all four panelists who I think have given really outstanding presentations that really highlight the innovative work that social sciences can bring into public health. And I guess I wanted to start just by asking a sort of basic question that has to do with the scientific process itself. I think each of you sort of told a story of how your research and your thinking evolved either from study to study or building from one data set to the next or having one experience that leads into another. And I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that process for you, but also highlight how you equipped yourself with the tools that you needed to go from next data set to next data set or next project to next project. I think that's really important, not only for those of us who are interested in building from our initial findings into new ones, but for students who are interested in creating careers similar to yours, how you develop a trajectory and an arc that allows you to continue to build your skill set to tackle some of these issues and problems that you're seeing as you conduct your work. So I don't know who wants to start with that.
I will start. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay. I actually didn't speak directly to my most recent work, which is a follow-up on this, but I think this is a good opportunity in answering this question to talk about it. My current research is actually about financial debt and its impact on stress and health, and as you can probably imagine, that grew directly out of the study that I talked about. And what's interesting is that was not at all something that was on my radar when I went into the study on consumption and symbolic capital and health, but it clearly resulted from simply looking at the findings, which I was not expecting, right? I was expecting a very simple relationship between, oh, people who have more of these status markers are going to have better health and be less stressed. And of course, I found a much more complicated picture that made me really dive into this literature on the political economy of consumption and go back to my social scientist, you know, roots and read Marx again and, you know, read Weber again and deal with all of those kinds of issues. And it also was a lot more complex in terms of thinking about why would I see these very different relationships between the impact of symbolic status on teenagers depending on what their family's economic status was. And one of the obvious issues that had to come out of that was thinking about the financial strain of trying to attain status through material goods when you don't have that basic economic standing. And it has led me down this path of looking at financial debt, which is a whole other question for me that I'm fascinated by now and is proving to be really fruitful in terms of different avenues to take that. So for me, I think it's just been a process of keeping my mind really open as I'm interpreting my findings and thinking about these questions more deeply and trying to look at it from multiple angles.
My response is slightly different. I would attribute the shift in my research or the augmentation of my research to structural forces. At Columbia University, we have the Robert Wood Johnson Health and Society Scholars Program. I've been gracious enough to be a site faculty member and sitting sort of week after week after week with economists and other social scientists, public health specialists, epidemiologists, week after week after week, even as a faculty member, learning about, you know, you were talking about, Elizabeth, well, everyone knows that stress is related to inflammation, and literally like a year ago, I was like, wow, this is amazing. I need to know more about this. And being in an environment where a young professor can learn about these different sort of systems, both all the way from the policy level all the way to learning about microbial factors, I think has really contributed to the expansion of my research. So I'm a big fan of supportive structures for people at all the stages of their career as professors and scholars and public policy folks.
I guess I'll say that I never thought of myself as a measurement person or interested in measurement, and yet a lot of what I guess I ended up doing was really about measurement. And I think it, in terms of the story part of it, that it, I started out getting interested in stigma, and a lot of the measurement was really at the individual level and about people's appraisals of the extent to which they perceive they've been discriminated against. And I think that's an important to capture it in Valerie's work, certainly shows the importance of appraisal processes. But when you're interested in mental health like I am, it raises a lot of concerns about reverse causality and people who have worse health are more likely to perceive discrimination. And there are all kinds of psychological and motivational processes that lead people to over or under report discrimination experiences. And a lot of those questions focus on interpersonal events. You know, have you been discriminated against in the context of housing or education or employment? And again, those are all very important, but they weren't capturing some of the more structural conditions. And so that led me to then try and operationalize some of the structural conditions. And one of the interesting things about studying LGB populations is, unlike other stigmatized groups where some of these institutional forms are really ubiquitous exposures, there's a lot of variation in these policies and attitudes across the state level in the US. And just about a couple years ago, I was very lucky that a lot of data sets started assessing sexual orientation that had health in them and that made data available at the state level where we could sort of leverage some of that. So some of it was luck as well. And I'll give an RWJ shout out as well. I think that, you know, at each point after the first paper where it was just cross-sectional and established a relationship between these policies and health, that was about the time I was applying for postdoc and felt like I needed additional training in sociology and population health and these sort of multi-method approaches. And so from a training perspective, that was really invaluable, I think, for me to get the tools that I needed to be able to address the questions I was interested in that, as a clinical psychologist by training, I hadn't been exposed to. And so.
Yeah, so I think the best ideas, I think, come from reading just a ton. Just read a lot, read widely in lots of fields. I write down all my ideas. Like, on Evernote, I have a list of, you know, 1,000 ideas by now, and most of them are just totally insane, and I'd never admit to anybody. But then you try to pick a few of them that carry weight. I think my situation is a little different because I'm a newspaper columnist, so I need to, people have to talk about my things and be interested in them, email them, or else I'll lose my job, basically. So, and there are lots of things that I write about that are really important and like that I care about a lot. I wrote an op-ed about child abuse and how much child abuse actually went up in the recession, and basically nobody emailed it or talked about it or cared, or like poverty, nobody cares about. So like I write a lot more about sex now, which like always gets emailed. My next column's gonna be basically just shameless. It's all about sex. I call it Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Sex But Didn't Have the Data to Ask, like a pun on, pun on Woody Allen. And like that's like lock. Everyone's gonna email it, talk about it. I like can keep my job for like a few more months after that, so. But I don't know how related that is to anything anybody else does, but that's my situation.
So Seth, thanks for that response, because it actually leads me, I'm gonna skip the question I had to move to another one, which is, I didn't wanna, you know, you guys are all doing such innovative and interesting and cutting edge work, and Seth, you started us off by saying you really were just driven by interesting questions and sort of rejected sort of the academic establishment around getting your work published in mainstream academic journals. and going into the media, but it sounds like your hands are still strapped a little bit by what you can talk about and write about based on what popular culture sort of says we want to digest. And I guess speaking though for the to the panel as a whole, how do you find what are the challenges in being able to implement these novel new approaches when we still are in a somewhat dated and some would say backwards system of funding research, of even publishing and allowing for academic freedom to truly exist? So I just wondered if you could talk a little bit about your experiences actually developing these research portfolios and maintaining them even in the face of perhaps conditions in which it's quite challenging to continue doing cutting-edge work that answers questions maybe that we think are important but that aren't necessarily going to get published, to sort of harken back to the first panel.
Someone from my department is here, and I don't have tenure yet. So did you hear that, Gerald? Cutting-edge work, innovative. That's me. and I that's like all I think about these days. How am I going to get promoted? You know, I never thought I would be a professor. I always, my highest aspiration was to be a third grade teacher. And so I was a Columbia undergraduate and I graduated with a B minus average and I was a pretty awesome basketball player. So part of it is that I always feel like I've won just because I'm here. So I kind of, my passion is for the ideas that I see in the Harlem community and around us, and I really just don't think too much about my career. I just think about the questions. And what I have found over time is that focusing on the questions and then focusing on putting together the right team together to get to the questions drives the science itself. I can't believe I'm saying this, but there's been a sort of really, there was a radical shift with the National Institute of Health, or NIMH, I think it was like maybe about 4 or 5 years ago, where they really said to the work that I do in social psychology that they were like, we are not going to fund work that doesn't have implications for mental and physical health. And while many social psychologists were really distraught, I mean, I actually saw that as a real charge that we need to start thinking seriously about how the little tiny laboratory things that we do can actually speak to broader issues of sex, sexuality, financial strain, policies. And I do think that it has pushed our field in some negative directions, but I also think it has pushed our field in positive directions. So I do think that these larger shifts can sometimes push us to like sort of keep our work interdisciplinary.
So I think there are definitely compromises you have to make, and that's something I'm learning more and more as you go through life. And you like if you have like, well, I kind of did it. Well, I did everything wrong initially. Like I think I should have. When I first wrote like my work, I don't think it's even that radical, but I kind of wrote it up as like, you know, surveys are so horrible. Why does anybody do a survey? Like Google searches of the future, and people who have built their careers on surveys are going to be like, you know, screw you. Like I don't want it. Like especially since I probably didn't know what I was talking about. So, like I think there are ways you kind of have to pick your battles, and there are ways even if you have subversive or radical ideas, like. There are ways to write them that maybe are a little bit more acceptable to people and actually will have more impact than just saying whatever you want and saying however you want to say it. So I think I've made a lot of mistakes in that department. I think, you know, I think there definitely are, really pick your battles and pick where you want to have your fights and pick where you're willing to compromise. So.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I guess I have a few thoughts on this, which is, I guess I'll start with, you know, I'm also coming from a very interdisciplinary place, like everybody here, and I'm, you know, my home field is anthropology. I also have an MPH. I did the Robert Wood Johnson, you know, postdoc as well. And I remember coming out of that postdoc with a little bit of an identity crisis, honestly, because I was doing this work that, you know, really was kind of bridging both fields, and in anthropology I was encountering some resistance around it being a little bit too public healthy,
you know, the specific method that I use, that consensus and consonance method. It's a mixed methods approach that is embraced by a very, very small number of people within anthropology, and it also encountered a lot of resistance, and for good reasons. I certainly don't think that that's the best way to approach all questions, but it was a good way for me to be able to link something cultural and complex and social with something biological. But that definitely didn't fly with everybody. And so I was faced with that, you know, to what degree, how do I compromise in that way to make myself fit better in anthropology. And in a lot of ways, what I was doing in terms of my work fit better within public health. And I kind of went that direction, and I ended up in a medical school where I was in this very soft money, completely soft money environment. And then I encountered this other issue of how do I make this, you know, very anthropological work that I'm doing relevant to funders, and how do I make it relevant enough that I can fully fund myself in a soft money position. And that turned out to be really hard. And also encountered a lot of resistance. One of my senior advisors in my former department at a medical school, if I'm just going to be very candid here, pulled me aside when I was working on my new grant about the financial debt and health, and said, you know, I'm going to give you very honest advice that I really think you need to drop this whole thing about debt because it's too political. And you're in a medical school now, and you need to be, you know, the only thing you should care about is getting funded. And, you know, I had to make these decisions in my career about pursuing what I loved and pursuing what was going to get me money, and the only thing you should be worried about is getting money. And my whole life, my attitude to getting that kind of advice has been to just double down on doing the opposite because it just really rubbed me the wrong way. And so I did. I doubled down on this grant, and I got an R01, so it worked out. So I guess that's kind of my advice is, yeah, you do need to pick when to compromise and when not to. But definitely do not always compromise. I think sometimes you need to just stick with your gut and do what you love, because I think we do our best work when we're doing what we love and what we're passionate about.
I'll be really fast because I know there are questions over there. But I guess really quickly about the political comment, I tried to get some of the same-sex marriage papers published in more medical journals, and I had one editor write back and say, I can't touch this, it's too political. And so it's interesting that political issues come up in your work. And then this may be very specific to the area I work in, but my biggest challenge is actually getting data sets that measure sexual orientation that have enough variation at the structural level. So I've actually, for just one example, the youth risk behavior surveillance studies that come out of the CDC, there's only maybe a handful of jurisdictions now that actually include a measure of structural stigma. And I'm now actually going to use that as a measure of structural stigma for the states that don't include it. And it actually turns out it's correlating with some of the outcomes that we're interested in. So, but I'm sort of envious of other areas where it's sort of commonplace to include these, you know, what I consider to be basic measures, demographic measures. But we're so far behind in that field, I think largely because of the stigma around this topic, particularly among youth and asking some of these questions.
So I do want to open it up for questions. I know that we have some people queued up, but others, please find the microphones or microphone to the right of the room. So please.
I'm Jack Toko. I'm an anthropologist and a postdoctoral fellow at the HIV Center here at Columbia. My question primarily is directed to Mark. I'm currently applying for a student loan repayment grant from the NIH through the Health Disparities Track, and I was dismayed to find that LGBT populations are not considered a health disparity population according to the NIH. And I'm wondering whether you see this as an issue of structural stigma, or if we need another frame to think about that, and also on a more practical level, how do we change it?
I've had many conversations with people there about this. The only way you can study it right now is if you look at intersectionality questions. So if you have a racial, ethnic, sexual minority group or rural LGBT populations, but it's not currently considered, as you're saying, a disparity group. I think a lot of that is about stigma. I think there are changes in the leadership there that are more open to these kind of changes. I think it's just a slow political process. I do think my experience in talking with the people there is they're very open to this and want to see it included, but it's going to take time. But I think reaching out. I mean, I've had, as I said, a lot of conversations with them. I know others have as well. And the more it's on their radar that that this is something that we want to see changed, I think the more that the more likely they are to do it. Although I don't know if that's a Pollyanna-ish view, but yeah.
Hi. Patty Mabry, NIH. So to respond to the previous questioner, since I am from NIH, why don't you drop me, excuse me, drop me an email and I'll put you in touch with the people who are working on this issue within NIH. Not everything is easy to find. We're a big organization and sometimes there are barriers, but if you get to the right people, they might know how to get around those. So I think that's at least worth a shot. I'll try to help you. Okay, now to the panel. Thank you very much for your wonderful panel today and all the presentations that you gave. I want to offer a few things that are not, since it is about innovative or innovations in concepts and methods, I want to say a few things about the methods issues and try to say them in a way that's meant to strengthen, get you to reconsider your work, or not reconsider, but consider your work in ways that might help strengthen it. So that's the spirit of this, to help you strengthen your work. So regarding Seth, this, first off, is you're talking about big data, the Google searches, et cetera, and Facebook data. So this can fit under big data. And remember, previously in my panel, I talked about BD2K, big data to knowledge. So anybody in this room that's working with that kind of data or interested in that kind of data, think about getting funding for that through this door. But of course, when we talk about big data of this type, this is opportunistic data. And it's great because it's in large volumes and it's ubiquitous, but some of the downsides are, of course, the privacy and confidentiality issues, so you have to at least consider that. I know you didn't have time in your talk to go into that. But also, we have to think about what the data represents, and maybe there's a complementary way that this kind of data can complement the survey type data. So data that can be intentionally asked versus data that's scraped. So I think that things like you talked about the gay porn searches. How much of those searches are from researchers who are researching this issue? Okay, so that's a compound that's in there. Or things like that. Mark, you talked about integrating different data sets. And I think the survey, the morbidity and mortality data, and some, I can't remember the name of the survey, that's really important type of work, and we probably should need more of that. So I think people in this room can think about in terms of methods, what are some methods that can help to bridge different data sets and make them useful like you did. Elizabeth and Valerie, not that this shouldn't be for others too, but think about replication of your results. Make your data, make your work open so that someone else can replicate your findings. So Valerie, you had this very exciting finding that a 15-minute writing intervention 2 years later can drop body mass. I would think everybody in this entire country would want to go out and implement that intervention right away. 15 minutes for, you know, payoff for the long term, it sounds almost too good to be true. I'm not trying to be skeptical, but I think all of us have to make sure that our work is open to being reproduced so that we can find out and solidify that finding.
We've actually replicated it 3 times.
Good, then publish all of that and let someone else replicate too. Yeah. There have been studies, there was an example given at this meeting that I was at the other day of a study that was, the own lab could replicate, but then when another lab in another city tried to replicate it, they could not. Then a different group who was also in the same city as the first one tried to replicate it and they could. So what was going on? It turned out it was the mouse shavings in the cage, the brand of mouse shavings being used. Okay, and that sounds kind of far-fetched, but really if you think about the microbiome and its importance, and the shavings might have some kind of bacteria in them that contribute to the microbiota of the organism, the living in that environment, then it might really be, oh, now I see. So at any rate, just make your work open. I'm glad to hear that you're replicating it, at least for yourself. That's the minimum. And then also in terms of your work on understanding these levels of intervention, I'm not against doing multiple levels of intervention. What I think you want to make sure of is that you understand which levels are contributing how much.
So yeah, exactly,
that's,
right.
That's going to be a methodological challenge for you.
We do that. Well, yeah, we do that.
Okay. So thank you all.
Okay, you want to say anything back?
I don't don't know that they were questions.
Thank you for the advice.
Yeah. I definitely agree on the connecting surveys with the new data sources. That's actually one of the things I'm researching a lot now. What? Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that's a focus of research, and I think there are advantages to surveys. You're actually asking a question, you know what it means, that you don't have in some of the new data sources. So I think combining them is actually going to be very, very fruitful and one of the more exciting areas of research.
Yeah, and just one thing really quickly about linking data sets. I contacted Seth and got his measure of racism using Google racial search terms and linked it to a health data set, and it strongly predicts black-white mortality differences. So I think there are a lot of opportunities for taking Google measures and linking them into existing health data sets and using them as measures of social context.
I just wanted to comment quickly. It's great to talk. You know, I'm an experimental social psychologist, so what we do is we have really tight experimental design. So for example, we're working on a study at Harvard where we're randomly assigning participants to go to a cancer screening in a church, structural intervention, randomly assign them. On another condition, they do nothing. And the third condition, it's the structural intervention plus the psychological intervention. So you can tease apart the sort of causal process. Yeah.
Bruce. Good, well, comments are almost the flip side of the last one, which I bet we would agree if we sat down and talked to each other. But I want to focus on what was really great about this panel. And I wanted to do it in the context of the morning's conversation about sort of what's wrong with the social sciences, and Peter's description of it has gotten too narrow and all obsessed with selection and the like. In the social sciences, and I think in the public health sciences, we have the problem of a different kind of a narrowness, which is a whole bunch of publications that are very formulaic, that really don't grapple with an idea, but you know, just something. But these three, I don't know if I bet the rest of the audience feels pretty much the way I felt about how impressive these four talks were. And you know, it may be obvious why they are, but I wanted to bring out why I think they are. And the first one is that as a counterbalance to what we said this morning about tackling little questions, none of these was a little question. It was a big issue. The other thing that was really strong about them is that each one gave a new way of seeing something that we wouldn't see if you didn't do it. So the new measure, the new design, and so on, and the Google search and so on. And that's really important because that's how we move things forward. If we do it in a theoretical line, we see something new, we can test new ideas, we learn more. So that. And then finally, each one of them, in one way or another, was programmatic. That is, one thing led to another. And I think this is critically important in things we have to teach our students of how to do that. And and it helps with the replication idea, because if you get on the line of something and you keep following it, it builds to something that's more dramatic. And it's also more useful to people if they can see it's working and it's a story, like Valerie indicated. So I kind of agreed with the panel this morning that things are kind of bad, but you're younger, and this is this is super exciting for me, and I think you did a great job at doing that. And so you got a cheerleader.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hear, hear. I don't know if you guys want to respond. Ron, do you want to ask?
So the question is I guess it's in a fancy way, it's called the counterfactual. So had you, instead of being in the institutions you're in, had you been in traditional academic departments, how do you think the nature of your work, I don't think it would have affected the methodological, you know, your methodological innovations as Bruce was describing them, but how do you think the nature of the work you did and the kinds of questions you were willing to tackle would have been shaped had you been in traditional, psych type departments at traditional universities? And I raised the question because in part what motivated the idea of doing this is how could we strengthen relations between the uptowns and the downtowns, the schools of public health and academic departments. What we heard this morning is maybe we shouldn't be trying to strengthen those relationships, because those relationships would in fact be stultifying for the kind of work you have decided to do. So I'm wondering how you reflect on, you know, what you've heard described as the kind of nature of the traditional social science departments now, and how it would have affected your capacity to do the kind of innovative work you do.
Well, just to add to that, because I had a very similar question, it seems though that you guys, many of you did come from very sort of pure social science departments, experimental social psychology, clinical psychology, anthropology, economics, but yet you have a very interdisciplinary way of examining your questions. And I was also interested in understanding the tension between, is it just the use of methods, or is it in how you are conceptualizing these phenomena and issues? And to me, it seems like the latter, but how do you get there from your very pure foundations in clinical psychology, social anthropology, economics, et cetera?
The training program I was in, I was in the Department of Psychology, but it was not a strict mentorship model, and that to me was huge. It was a junior colleague model, and meaning they really encouraged you to design a programmatic line of work, and you could work with people across departments. So my two main mentors were in clinical psychology and social psychology, but also across schools. And so I worked with folks, including those here at the School of Public Health as well. So I think from a very early time, I really sought that out and felt that that kind of interdisciplinary approach was really important. But then I felt that I had to go get additional training during postdoc to continue that. And then I guess to answer Ron's question, I mean, I went on the market to look at more traditional psychology programs and felt like I couldn't do the work I wanted to do. I think SMS is a perfect place for me to do this work, because I have daily, my office is next to two sociologists and an anthropologist, and it's inspiring, but it also pushes me to think in an interdisciplinary way, that if you're going to your office every day and the people you're eating lunch with and having conversations with are only within your same discipline, I think it can be a little stultifying in that way. But and that said, I think it's important to keep an anchor in your discipline, like Chris was saying on the first panel. And so I think these interdisciplinary departments, for me at least, are the best of both worlds, because you can maintain that disciplinary perspective because you're working with people within your discipline, but you're having these conversations and working collaboratively with colleagues who are in other disciplines as well. So that's worked well for me.
Yeah, I completely agree. I mean, I am coming from an anthropology background, but I did my MPH simultaneously, so I was always kind of interdisciplinary. And, you know, one of the comments I repeatedly get from anthropology colleagues about my work is, wow, it's so relevant, you know, as if that's some kind of, like, exotic thing with an anthropology to do something relevant. You know, so I think there's no way I would have tackled such a big relevant question as health disparities and inequality. I would not have thought that big if I had just stayed within anthropology. But at the same time, if I had just done public health, I wouldn't have brought with me the unique methods, at least I think unique from anthropology, this mixed methods approach to try to ask these questions. And also, I think that it's really at the intersection of the two that I'm able to use that confluence of things to reflect back in an even bigger way on questions. You know, for instance, I'm not interested in biology or in health in and of itself. I'm interested in those things because they're a reflection of what's going on in society. You know, it's a way of saying something profound about what's wrong in terms of inequality and these bigger processes in society. And I think that making those connections was only possible for me by combining those two things, anthropology and public health.
Yeah, so I think I have a really broad set of interests. I'm very easily bored. Like, I get bored after, you know, I get insanely excited about something for about a month, and then I get bored of it. And so I wrote this first paper. It was about how much racism cost Obama. And I was like fascinated by this. I'm like, oh my God, this is cool. Like, this Google search is on it. Like, I'm a political junkie. I care about politics. Like, this, like, I was so into it. I was like telling everybody about it. And then my advisor's like, all right, now you're a race and voting expert. Like, that's who you are. Like, that's how this works. Like, you're a race and voting expert. In 30 years, you're going to be a race and voting expert. And you're going to be talking about, like, the theories about race and voting and, like, the different types of race and, you know, the 8 degrees of race, how they play into voting. I'm like, I can't do that. Like, there is no way. And I think that, you know, you're talking about what can academics do. I think, like, you got to, like, there's a value of specialization. There is. There's no question that the things I've written about, like, probably my naivete shows. And I probably should collaborate more with people and stuff. On the other hand, like, there's no way, I don't think that the 8th thing I've written, that I could have written on race and voting would be as interesting as the stuff on, like, gays or, you know, online hate groups or, you know, the sex column I'm going to write. Like, all these things are, like, I think way more interesting than the 8th thing I could have written on race and voting. So I think it's, you have to allow people to explore a little more than just this obscene specialization where you get a little, your mind gets a little stuck and stuff, and you don't really kind of allow yourself to explore things that are a little more interesting to you. So that would be my advice.
I am in a traditional department of psychology. I always have been at Stanford and then at Yale and at Columbia. So my work is my work. So what I will say is that similar to Mark, each of those schools have models that are very, very much leave you open to looking across disciplines. I always say this to Peter Bierman and Bruce Link, that if I knew any better, I would be a sociologist. So my hallmark is to take sociological questions and then to put them into experimental paradigms. That's what I like to do.
Well, thank you, each of you, very much for excellent presentations and for your comments. I think it's been a wonderful panel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you everyone for another really excellent panel. I want to thank Patrick, Mark, Elizabeth, Seth, and Valerie for sharing their ideas and contributing to this day. And next we're gonna take a lunch break. We've all been sitting for a long time. The lunch is served in the back room, and then we're gonna try and start promptly again at 1:15. So we look forward to having you join us this afternoon as well. Thank you.